Hello and welcome to video 12 of this series. So last time we had a look at the gap check, and today we'll have a look at the extraction. So I made a mistake last time. Also, no, not a mistake, I forgot something. The thing is, we implemented this gap check, but this is currently not entirely correct, because in these chains, the standard says that also, let's look again at this. So even if there is a division of this packet, yeah, here between these frames, the standard says that there in between could also be an idle frame. An idle frame is also a frame count. And the thing is, if you remember in one of the previous episodes, we threw away the idle frames already after the decoding of the frame. So we shouldn't do this, right? So we did this on the, yes, here. When we converted the NCDU to the TM frame, and we added this unless the first header pointer is the idle frame point, which marks this, this is an idle frame, only then we yield it, otherwise we throw it away. And we cannot do this now. So just remove that. That's the first step. So then we get all the frames divided up by the vertical channels, and then we can test the gaps for the vertical channel on the vertical channels themselves. Okay, that's good. Then let's go to the extraction. So last video also already showed you the push packet. The push packet has its own parser, which just delivers the packet itself. We try to use that now. The thing is, as I already told last time, we need then also to take into account the first header pointer if we are missing frames and so on. So let's try to implement this now. So this will be multi-steps with multiple refactorings probably. So let's see. Let's call this extract packets, which is a conduit T, which takes a TM frame meter, and we want to have POS packets. Right? And so, first thing, okay, your push packet is not in scope, so also we should start probably ghcid, also that we have the messages here. So we should import push packet. Right, so we have an empty do block, that's correct. So first thing, of course, we need to get pull the frame from upstream. So we do this await, and in case this is of and this is annoying, I'll just restart Visual Studio Code. Sometimes it does this. Okay, back. So I hope, I don't know if this from is the of this is from Haskell language server or from Visual Studio Code. I have no idea. But sometimes if you enter something and then always it scrolls up one line. So this is quite, really quite annoying. So in case we have nothing, again, we should close the chain. And if we have a meter frame, then we have to do the work. So as we have now, and GSCID again. So as we have now just started up the frame, we are, this is the very first frame we get. So we have to check the first header pointer of the frame. So let's just get the first header pointer. FHP is, we get the frame from the meter, and from the frame we get the frame header. And from the frame header we get the, oh my god, frame header FHP. Okay. So now we have the frame header pointer, and then we have to compare it. So let's do a multivariate if. So first thing, if we have an idle frame, we should throw it away. So if FHP is, how did we call that? Idle frame FHP. then we just throw the frame away and loop over. So we go back up and await the next. So we call ourselves extract packets conduit. In case the FHP is, we have also one case. Let's go to the frames again. So the packets are stored in the frame, but if a packet is very large, so it's larger than the frame, then maybe the first part of the packet gets into a frame, then there's a frame which contains only part of the packet and the rest of the packet is in another frame, or this can span multiple frames. So there's an indication that there is no, because this FHP is the first header pointer. So if there is no header in the file, which means there's the frame is filled with a part of a large packet, this is also the case. And this is, yes. And here we have it. Here we have it. So if no packet primary header starts in the transfer frame data field, the first header pointer is set to all ones. So we just copy this value and put this also into the frame. So we say no FHP. And this is also a word 16. Right? And of course we have to export it. So if this is then the no FHP, we have to do the same. We are in the very first frame we get and we don't find a packet inside there, we cannot stop parsing. So we can just throw it away. Okay, yeah, multi-wave needs to be turned on. That's absolutely right. We haven't done that. So library, where is it? Multi-wave. Post packet is not in scope. Okay. We have imported it. And of course, I forgot to. Export it. Okay. Right. Meta frame. Pattern matches are non-exhaustive. Absolutely correct. So. Then we have the case that the frame header pointer is zero, and this is the easy case. We just get the data out of it. So we have to again meta frame, and then we have the frame data. Meta. And let's do it now with parentheses because we need to pass that to a function. And so we pass this simply to, let's call this process packet conduit. So we pass the binary string on, so we should pass it. Okay. And then we have additionally the case that the FHP is greater than zero. And this is basically, we get the first frame in this case. So the first header pointer points somewhere, and this first data we simply cannot pass because we don't have information about the previous thing. So we have to throw it away. So basically we do the same, but what we also do is we drop the first FHP bytes, bytes from this byte string, and we will probably need and we will first import byte string, of course, and yeah, we have not defined process packet C. This is also correct. Process packet C undefined, and then we couldn't match type int. This is also because the FHP is a word 16, so we have a from integral FHP. Okay, good. And it still says, so we have basically covered all our cases, but it's still the same again. So GHC says cannot do something, so we still say an absurd undefined, because basically we cannot come here. And multi-wave and pattern guides and everything is different. So, okay. Good, first step. So this is when we begin a stream and we tap into something. So what shall we do then in within this function? The thing is, we want to also concatenate the data if a packet is split across two frames. And fortunately, autoparsing itself provides an incremental parsing functionality, and that's exactly useful. So let's have a look at that. Blah, blah, blah. We have that so we have this parse function which returns a result, and the result is an I result with byte string. So we have three constructors. Done is okay, we have successfully passed. Fail, okay, we have successfully failed. And partial is okay, we didn't have enough input, so we get this function here, which is a continuation. And if we feed this function with an additional byte string, then it can resume parsing and continue. Yeah, so that's exactly what we want. This is exactly what we need. So let's do this. So we have to call this parse function. So basically, we pass this byte string. So let's see. This is the rest from the previous, or let's call it dot. Doesn't matter how we call it. And we want to parse this data. Parse, and then we need to pass in parse. Parse needs the parser, the byte string, and then it delivers a result. Okay, so the parser is the post packet parser. The byte string is in this case dot, and rejected. So we can have multiple results. So the first thing is we can fail, and fail has three parameters, right? It has the E is the input that has not been consumed, so this is the rest. Then we have a list of strings, which is a context in which the error occurred, and then we have an error message. So we ignore the first two one, and we have an error message. And the thing is, the only sensible thing, if the parser fails, the only sensible thing we can do is we can terminate the chain and then restart it. That's all we can do. Because if this parser fails, then it's something is really, really wrong. So we logged it, log error parsing this packet from, and we give it an error. So this is a string, and we have no display instance for a string. So we pack it here. As this is not in the critical path, so if we have an error, we are not in the performance critical path anymore. So, and then frame, just lock the frame also. Display show. We don't have the frame. Okay, then we don't lock it. Right. And then we just return. That's it. Just end the loop. Okay. Then if we are ready, if we have done, and done returns, done returns the input that has not been consumed and the result. Okay. So we have a rest, which has not been consumed, and we have a packet. So what we shall do, it's easy, we shall yield the packet for now, and have to parse the rest. So there are packets just following. So what we will call is process packet C, on the rest. And yeah, now we have the failed things. Data, I haven't imported it. Nope. So let's import at the parsec byte string. And then we have a big ambiguous occurrences. So let's import this qualified. And then we have to do if fail a done and probably a parse. Would not match expected type. Ah, yeah, okay, yeah. We forgot the dollar sign. Couldn't use, yes, and if we use logging, we have, of course, this is the monad.io. We need the monad reader env, and we need the haslog func env. Right, compiles. Of course, and now we have the interesting and the critical case, the partial. Partial. And partial delivers us a continuation. So, what do we do in this case? Well, we have to get the next frame, extract the data part out of it, and pass it to this continuation. Should be simple enough, but let's do this in another function. So, process continuation packet Z, and we pass it the continuation. Yeah. Okay. So let's see. In this function, what we have forgot here also, we have a continuation. And let's just say undefined so that we compile at least. Yes, we do. The thing is, this process packet C, what we also have is, we loop over here, but the thing is, if this is this byte string we pass here is empty, then we cannot do anymore. So we need to get the next frame. Yeah, so we have the same problem. So we should basically also do a case b null dot. And in this case, what we do is, again, we pull the next frame, await. Case x of nothing, we close the loop. And if we have emitter, what do we do? With this meter, we get out. Basically, we have to call this. So we call ourselves with the new data, right? Hopefully. Is this enough? Unexpected case expression. Yeah. Okay, yeah, and in case otherwise, of course, we do. We do this. Compiles, good. So first, then we have to do the same thing here. So if we have a continuation, basically also we have to get the packet. And if we have got it, then we have to do something different. We have to parse it with the continuation. So we have to get the frame data, frame meter. And pass it to the continuation. So to this one, which we got here. And this continuation is a function from I to an I result again. So we get another result here. And we have basically the same again. So we have the case off. And then we have basically also something similar. Let's see. Okay, so in fail, case, we fail and simply return. If we are done with a packet, we yield the packet, then we call the process packets of this other function again with the rest. So far, so good. And if we have again a partial cont, then we have to call ourselves again with this continuation. Right. And so these functions will basically interchange themselves for now. So this is the first step. There are some things we haven't done yet. And maybe we should also then, for of course, this is quite similar. So maybe we should factor that out. Let's think about it. So the thing is, it's just this one is different. The rest is the same and the continuation is different. Well, we have some additional steps to do. So first we haven't done the gap check. That's the important thing. So every time we do this await, of course, this is the very first await we did, so we don't have to do it here. But this is the loops in which we call await. We have to check the gap. And we have to do that before we process the packet. So this is what we haven't done yet. So we have the meta gap of meta. If this is nothing, then we just process it, the binary data. But if we have gap, what do we do? Well, first we log a warning. Gap in TL frames detected. Old for VCFC. Okay, let's old VCFC. VCFC display old VCFC new display VCFC. So we log a warning and then we throw this frame away. No, we don't throw the frame away. So the previous frame was missing and we don't know this frame because it's missing. So this new frame, we need to start from again. So we need to start basically not from here because then we would read another frame. So we need to start here basically. So let's factor that out also under the where clause. And let's call this first frame conduit something like that. And then in this case, here we just call first frame C and we need to pass it the meta. And also we have to have the meta here. Okay. And so we have the gap detected, so we have to start again this first frame. First frame with the meta. And this will again check in the first header pointer and throw away the packet if necessary and synchronize up so that we get to the first header so that we can actually start of the next, that we get to the first header of the next packet so that we can start passing again. And then this will, so this should handle this correctly. This will then call process packet and so on. And this will loop over. first frame C meta. And the thing is, we also have to do this here, right? Before we can get into parsing, we have to do this. So, so we got the meta, yes. And case meta get meta of nothing. Just let's switch that up. Because we have, if we have a gap, then we have to restart again from first. But if we have nothing, then we don't call process C, but we do our stuff here. Okay, and now it's time for refactoring because we do the same thing here and here. So let's factor this out. X await, yes. So this whole part, let's call this next frame, something like that. Yeah. And so in this case, we need to call process packet C. And here we need to call this function. So we give it and here we call first frame C. Here we call first frame C meta, right? So all we need to do is factor out this function. So let's also call this some kind of continuation. And in this case, we call get next frame C, and the continuation is process packet with the frame, and we need the frame we get from inside. So this is basically then something like that. And here we call not process, but the continuation with the meta. Okay, that's good. And in this case, so basically we could remove that now. First frame, yes, that's okay. And something like that. And also in this case, what we are doing here, first frame C. And then we have to pass in this, so we get the meta, and do something like that. And let's comment this for now. Okay, so silly mistake. I made a silly mistake. Yes, next frame C, we just called the wrong function. And we give it this is a function which takes a meter, then applies the continuation to the frame data, and then processes this again. And then we now should be able to delete this. and it should compile, right? So also, what we can now do is add this to this chain, and this should also compile, everything good, okay? So, and then we have one thing that's still missing, or actually we have two things missing, unfortunately. So one thing is, the first thing is the CRC check. So we didn't do the CRC check on the packet. So as you remember on the frame, it was easy because we have the NCTRS data unit and there is exactly one TM frame inside, and this is, we know the length, so we just have the byte string to check. For the packet, it's different. So we need to read the header information of the packet. We need to read the length so that we know how much to read and then where the length is located. So this is a kind of chicken egg problem. So we need to parse at least partially the packet so that we get to know how to apply the CRC. And this is a little bit unpretty and also a little bit of a problem in the standard itself. So the thing is, if the CRC fails, most of the time it just fails and it will tell you, but if the CRC fails because the length field has been altered on the transmission, then the length will be incorrect and then you get completely wrong data. And then it's hard to synchronize up to the next valid TM packet header. So that's a little bit of unfortunate thing. It can be done. It's a little bit difficult to then check if you have if the next passed frame, so if the length is wrong, then you get a wrong header. And the thing is, you can't tell that the header is wrong because in the standard every field is uses all maximum values, so you have no reference values which you can check against. The only exception is the version number, and the version number can have different values for different protocols, so it's also not that pretty. So we have to live with that somehow. And the thing is, how to do this now? So we can do the can't do the step approach, but fortunately AutoParsec has again something that saves us, and this is the match function. Here it is. The match function. And this is return both the result of a parse and the portion of the input that was consumed while it was being parsed. So if we call a parser on this, yeah, in our case the parser for the push packet, and then we get as a result not only the push packet here, but also the byte string that corresponds to this push packet. And that is exactly what we need to check. So this function is sometimes extremely helpful. So the thing is, we need to, let's see, get next frame. So when we parse, we need actually to call match on this parser, on our push packet parser, and of course it has to be a match, and then we get a type error here because the packet is then not anymore. So then we get the byte string, the bin packet, and the packet itself, and before we yield the packet downstream, we have to check the CRC. So the CRC, we have to import the CRC field, and we have to check CRC and call this on the byte string, and we get a bool. So if check CRC of this bin packet, then we do this. So we just yield the packet, and call this with the rest in a loop. Yeah. When the CRC check fails, first thing is we log a warning, or an error, better. CRC check failed on push packet. We still get a parsed packet, probably. So we can display show it, hopefully. And what should we do then? Well, if the CRC check fails, basically the packet is corrupt. We can try to just continue from here. or we could abort and start processing from again. So we'll take from here, we take the risk and to try just continue. So we process packet C with the rest. Right, check CRC is not in scope. We have to import CRC. And then we have the same, of course, here. Because the continuation, so this continuation we get in the partial case, we get a continuation and we call it here. The continuation, of course, also it is the same partial. So we have the same here, pin packet packet. And if CRC, check CRC pin packet, we do exactly the same. Or yield packet process packet C, yield packet process packet C, or we log an error and process packet the rest. Oh, one else too much. Compiles, good. And as we see, this is also exactly the same, so maybe we should also factor this out. So check CRC, no, do check CRC. So let's copy that. Because it's the same. Yeah, it's basically the same. So and we need to pass in the bin packet. Or yes, we can also do bin packet pass in the tuple itself. Right? And also we need to pass in the rest. Yeah. So what we do here then is simply do check CRC rest and let's call this result. And then remove this. Compiles, very good. And here the same. Do check CRC rest result. Remove this. Move this to result. And compiles. So, okay. We have now also the CRC check implemented. A little bit of caveats for this caveats. But yeah. Could be that we get into the correct thing with the next frame if there is something wrong with the CRC and the length. Yeah, but as I said, this is generally a weakness of the protocol. And then there is one thing still missing because we now can parse post packets and generate them. Actually, let's see if this works. Yeah, so stack run and we pass in the signal. Yes. Let's just see if this runs and then we do the final change for today. And that looks good. So we have a post packet, we have a TM packet, this has a secondary header with an APIT, six standalone, so sequence count. A header length of 60, the length of the packet 63 bytes. We have a secondary header with a post type 3 and a subtype 25. That's a satellite housekeeping telemetry. So that's data from the satellite itself, not from an instrument or a camera or whatever. So it's zero. And then we have the time. And then we have the data inside the packet. And we see there is some data inside. And then we have also another packet, PustTM, which has no secondary header and which has the special APIT. 2047 and the data is just this U and with this length. So this is this value is an idle packet, which I already said. So we can now remove the idle packets because this packet does not have any use anymore. So it's not like the idle frames. We could use it also for a gap check for the packet, so it would make sense to have this. So if we want to throw away the idle packets, it makes sense to have another conduit, which we can pass then or change the location in the pipeline. We will do that probably do later. So we have this packet, so this is good. So this type and subtype and the apit identify the packet, basically what packet it is and what the content looks like. And this is then for the next thing. But we have one thing missing, because as you remember, we have this TM frame, and then we have to put this TM frame into this meta frame, because we have the Earth reception time and the quality and the gap and then the frame. So we have some metadata, and exactly we have the same here. So basically what we really have is we need also some kind of metadata. So push packet meta. So let's call this pp meter. Oh god. So we have this pp ERT, the Earth reception time, we still want to have. So this is this UTC time. We also want to have the quality. PP meter quality. This was a quality flag, I think. Yes. For now, we don't do a gap check, so then we have the packet. So, deriving show. UTC time not in scope, yes, of course. Data calendar, LML import, data time lock. Right, compiles. Good. And now the fun starts, because we need to then not generate a push packet, but a meta packet. And of course, then we get our compile errors. So we have parsed this packet. And now we need to generate a meta packet out of it. Do we have another error? No, this is the only location where we do this. That's good. So let new packet, this guy, push packet meta. So we now need to fill the fields. So we need the UTC time, the meta quality, and the packet itself. So the packet itself is easy. We have the packet here, so just fill it out. And then this we need from the frame, and we don't have the frame here, so we have to pass in the meta frame somehow. And then we have this is meta ERT from the meta, and the quality is the meta quality from meta. And then we get, of course, another compile error. Pass error on input. Right, so. And then, of course, next thing, because do check CRC, where do we use it? We have to pass in the meta. And the thing is, we don't have the meta here, because we only have this byte string. That is only the byte string which we passed in from here. So we have to also pass in the whole meta. Let's for now do it like this, meta, and so we get the meta in, and then we have to pass this to this function. Okay. Yes, and then we have to yield a new packet, of course. And also process packet now takes a meta, so we have to pass the meta again back, and also here. And 218. Yes, same here. So we get the meta in. we parse this, but this is a new meta, or is it? Where do we call it? We call it here. So basically, we have to pass in this meta. Right? Yeah. If we use this, oh, we could use, no, this should be okay. So this meta is created by get next frame C. Oh no, this is the next meta. And the thing is, the ERT should be from the packet where the header is located. So this could be a previous meta. So we have to pass that also in. Meta old. And not here. We have to pass the meta old here. And here we have to pass process content packet. This is the partial case. Yes, we also have to pass the meta old here. And then we have blah blah blah. 218, yes. Something wrong here. Yes, meta old. And also here we have to call the meta. Right? And then we have still here process cont packet C meta old continuation. And do check CRC meta rest result. And what's happening here? Process packet C needs a meta and the byte string. Okay. Okay. So process packet C needs the meta, the old meta, and the frame data from the M, the new data. And of course, closing parentheses. Now it compiles. Woo! I hope this runs. Then we should get post packet metadata. So let's try that. The thing is, we don't have in this signal dump because it sends a packet, then it waits a little bit, then it sends a packet. So the frame is always one packet, one idle packet. So we won't see much here probably, yes. But we get the packet meta, we get the earth reception time, the quality is good, and then we get the packets as we have before. That's good for now. So of course, to be sure that this all works, we would have to write maybe a property-based test which generates random packets, puts them into the frame, but then we need also to write the frame encoding and the push packet encoding and the frame encoding themselves, and then define some properties and then try to test this. We will actually do something a little bit more. I will generate the test file which contains spillover packets and some mixed up packets, and then we will try this. I'm not sure if we can test also with the CRC. I think that's a little bit out of scope for this series, but we will try. So let me think about it, and we will see this in the next episode. And also in the next episode, we then can then later throw away the idle packets. Let's conclude for now. So basically, the good case works. Surprisingly, as you see, this is quite convoluted and a little bit complicated. So it looks very simple, but it's in fact, if you think about it, you have a lot of edge cases and it's not that simple at all. So we would have, of course, to test this more rigorously, but conclude this for now. So have a lot of fun. Thanks for watching. See you in the next episode.